Now, the last technique we're going to look at with respect to active illumination is the time of flight method. So this method is interesting in that what it's based on is the speed of light. So imagine you have a light source and you illuminate a surface. If you can measure the time that it takes for light to travel from the light source to the surface, back to the camera or the sensor, then that time can be used to compute the distance that light has traveled and therefore compute the depth of the point in the scene. That's the notion of time of flight. So time of flight is an old idea and extensively used in nature, particularly when one talks about the time of flight of sound. So there are animals such as bats, hedgehogs, whales that would simply throw calls out and then listen for the echoes of these calls to understand where things are in the three-dimensional space. This is called echolocation, and it's also called bio-sonar. That is their primary way of figuring out the three-dimensional structure of scenes as shown right here. It's also used by man-made systems like submarines, say for instance, to figure out how far land may be or how far a ship that is on the surface of water might be by looking at echoes once again. But this is in the context of sound waves. What we want to do is use time of flight in the context of light. That is, we want to measure the time of flight of light. So to do this, we need to know what the speed of light is. That's essential. And so I just wanted to share with you some of the experiments that were done, the early experiments that were done to measure the speed of light. Fascinating experiments, given the context and time when they were done. So the first one was by Galileo, which is early 1600s. That's in the early 17th century. And here is his experiment. It's just fascinating that he would even think about doing this. You have person A and person B separated by some distance. So his idea is that we're going to measure the speed of light by having person A open up his lantern. He has a shutter, opens it up and exposes and lets it emit light and open it up for a short time. And then when person B is able to see the light, then he is going to open up his shutter, and then person A is going to measure when that arrives back to him, when he is able to see it. In doing so, by taking this total time, perhaps you can compute the time that it takes for light to travel from A to B and back. Well, A to B and back is 2,000 meters, and it turns out that given what we know about the speed of light now, it actually takes 6.6 microseconds to travel that distance. And if you look at the reaction time of humans, physical reaction time to open a shutter, etc., etc. And by the way, Galileo was actually measuring time using his pulse back then. Ambitious project, but you have to give him credit for thinking about it. And so the fact is that light travels so fast that that even human reflexes for the experiments were just way too slow for this experiment to have succeeded. And then a couple of hundred years go by, and Fizeau comes along, who is a French physicist, and he constructs a truly remarkable experiment. Very interesting experiment. So here he has an observer, and here's a lens, and the observer is looking at the scene right here. And you have a light source that goes through a lens, and what you're seeing here is called a half mirror or a beam splitter. So it is positioned at 45 degrees. It takes light from this light source and reflects it in this direction. Ends up being focused right here. And at that point, he has what's called a cog wheel. So the cog wheel essentially has teeth and notches. Tooth, notch, that's a cog wheel. And this cog wheel can be rotated, and Fizeau was able to control the speed of rotation of the cog wheel. So his idea was the following, that if you rotate the cog wheel and this light right here, there's going to be essentially a packet of light that gets through one of these teeth as it rotates. And then it's going to go this long distance. Distance happens to be 8,633 meters. It travels this distance. And at the other end of this distance, he has a planar mirror that reflects this light back. So then it travels back through the same system. But by the time it travels back, for a certain speed, the cogwheel would have turned so that now you have a tooth that obstructs the light coming back in. So there is a certain distance, there's a certain speed of rotation of the cogwheel for which no light ends up making it back to the observer. And so by using the rotation speed of the cogwheel for which that happens and all these other dimensions in the experiment, he was able to figure out the speed of light. Really remarkable. And what he came up with is this number, 3.153 times 10 to the power of 8. Now, this is remarkable because the actual speed of light is now known to be very precisely 2.998 times 10 to the power of 8 meters per second. So just think about how close those numbers are and how he was able to arrive at that number with this very simple, clever experiment. So anyway, today we know what the speed of light is through various experiments and confirmations. So now that we know that, we want to develop a technique for measuring the distance of points in the scene using the time of flight of light. So the first way to do this is called pulse modulation. What you do is essentially have the source send out a pulse of light. This is very much the way that a flash works on your camera. It's just one burst of light and then it goes off. So there's your pulse. The pulse then travels at the speed of light, travels, hits the surface, and then makes its way back to the sensor. Gets reflected, of course, gets reflected in many directions, but we are concerned with the reflection back in the direction of the sensor. And then at some point, the sensor receives a pulse. And if you can somehow measure the delay or the time difference between the two pulses, the emitted pulse and the received pulse, then that time can be used to compute the distance that light has traveled using the speed of light. That's the basic idea. So the thing to bear in mind here is that you need a very good stopwatch right here that can measure these pulses with nanosecond accuracy. So that's one of the key technologies that has been developed. And the second thing to note is that when you send out a pulse, like I said, a pulse is very much like your camera flash, very short duration, very bright. You really need the duration to be super small, very, very short, in order to make sure that it is indeed a pulse. Otherwise, you're going to get a broad rectangular function, and that's going to make this measurement less and less precise. So if you want to make it infinitesimally small, you need to make it very, very strong, because otherwise you're not going to get any photons at the receiver end. So that's one of the downsides of this pulse modulation method, also called the flash method. So here is another way to do this, which is called continuous modulation. So in this case, the source actually sends out a temporally modulated function. So it's light, but you're modulating the amplitude of light. So I don't want you to confuse this wave that I'm showing here to have anything to do with the frequency or the wavelength of light itself. It's just the intensity of light the brightness is being modulated. So temporally modulated light wave that's being sent out here strikes the surface. The modulation is, of course, going to be preserved. It gets reflected, and then it's received by the sensor. So in this case, you have this emitted light right here, the modulated wave, and then the yellow one is the received wave right here. And once again, if you can find the phase difference between these two, then that gives you the delay, and that delay gives you the time that light took to get from the source to the sensor, and then that with the speed of light can be used to determine the distance that light has traveled. By the way, the single number distance is enough to find the depth of the scene point, because if you give me the distance, then basically I can look at this ray and this ray, and the sum of those two distances must be equal to the distance that I've measured, which is the distance that light has traveled. So there's only one point here that would satisfy any given distance that you compute. All right, so how do we measure this phase difference between the emitted light and the received light? For this, we're going to use a method that we have used before, which is correlation. So here's the idea. Here's your emitted light, and we can write it as cosine omega t. Omega here refers to the frequency of the modulation of this wave, the brightness modulation. So cosine omega t. And then the received light is going to be A, that is, it's going to be attenuated in some way by the scene itself, cosine omega t minus psi, which is the phase shift that we want to measure. Remember that if we measure psi, then we have all the information we need to compute depth. And then there's also some kind of ambient light that you measure, because the scene is not just illuminated by the source, but maybe illuminated by other sources. But we'll assume that to be constant and not modulated or changing over time. So that's O. So now we are going to introduce a third function right here, which is the reference signal. So what we're going to do is use a reference signal, S right here, which we're going to multiply the received light with. We're going to correlate it, multiply the two. And how do you multiply it? Essentially, it's a little bit like a pixel that's receiving light, but you're changing the gain of the pixel continuously as you're integrating or collecting the photons. So that would give you, the final result of that would be the correlation of this gain function with the incoming light function. So that's what this reference signal is right here. So there's some reference signal which it has the same frequency omega associated with it. So it's cosine omega t minus delta. Delta is what we'll call the reference phase. You can set it to whatever you want because you control this electronics right here. So now, the measured intensity by this pixel, after you've done this correlation over some substantial period of time, it could be 30 milliseconds, but that's going to be substantial compared to the frequency of modulation. Once you've integrated the, multiplied this, the incoming light with the reference signal and integrated that over the integration time of that pixel, you're going to get a measurement, I. And that measurement is for the reference signal phase, delta I. So when you do this, work this out, you get a very simple expression, which is the measured intensity I for the phase delta I, reference signal phase delta I, is some constant P plus Q times cosine delta I minus the phase that we are trying to measure, which is psi. So in this equation, you know delta I, that because you picked it, you've designed your reference signal, you know the intensity that you measured I, but you have three unknowns, P, Q, and psi. So it turns out that you can use three such measurements corresponding to three different reference signals with three different phases, delta 1, delta 2, and delta 3, so you get three intensities, and that's enough for you to compute psi, the phase. So now we have cameras where you have lots of pixels, reasonable resolution, maybe even 1 megapixel, where each pixel does this independently. It's able to multiply the incoming light with three different reference signals, and from those three numbers that it ends up integrating, it's able to compute the phase for each pixel. So you get a complete depth map. So there's your psi. Now you need to go in and find distance. So before you do that, you have to take your phase difference right here and convert that into time or time delay. And you do that by using the frequency of your modulation of the light wave right here, F. So you can take psi divided by 4 by pi f, which are f is a modulation frequency, and you get the time, that's the delay, multiply that with the speed of light, and you get distance traveled by light. Okay, as an example, if you have a phase difference of pi, and if you have a frequency of modulation of 30 megahertz, for example, then you get a distance of 2.5 meters. So what's interesting here is that this technique, actually the major advantage over other structured light techniques is that you can measure things with great accuracy even if they're really far away from the sensor itself. And so here's an example of the kind of information you end up recovering. This is in the context of driverless cars. So you have a car right here, you get depth maps that look like this, which are extremely detailed with very high accuracy, high enough accuracy that you can then from the depth map figure out what is a car, what is a pedestrian, and so on and so forth. And in the case of driverless cars, it turns out that these time of flight systems are not measuring all the pixels simultaneously. They're actually doing it either one or a few pixels at a time and then scanning the sensor around to get a complete 360-degree depth map, as shown here. And at the other end of the spectrum, so these are very expensive systems, and in fact, one of the challenges with driverless cars is to come up with time of flight systems that are less expensive. At the moment, and in fact, there was a time when the cost of your time of flight sensor was equal to or greater than the cost of your car itself, and that's a bit of a problem. So that's definitely changing because there's a lot of activity in this space. And then you also have, at the other end of the spectrum, these 3D cameras based on time of flight, this one from PMD Technologies, where you have, for instance, your LED right here, which either can throw out a flash or modulated light. And then you have a sensor in here that's able to measure the time of flight and then convert that into depth. And more recently, these time of flight sensors have started making it into mobile devices like smartphones and tablets. And in the coming decade or so, we'll see time of flight technology really become ubiquitous because we're getting to a point now where the technology is very inexpensive, especially for short distances, very inexpensive and compact. So when you take a picture, you have not only your brightness and color at every pixel in your picture, but also depth and very accurate depth. And that's going to change the game because you can do a lot of things with your pictures when you have depth as well.